So now we will listen to Shaiji. That's it.
Yeah, it's good.
We'll talk about equilibrium measures of affine fractals.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I would like to thank both peers for this invitation. It's very nice to see some colleagues and see on one side. So I will talk about affine fractals. I will spend most of my time, in fact, giving an overview of some research teams in this topic, and also presenting some results. Only towards the end, I will talk about my results, which are all joint works with EM Mollis. Yeah, it will be a bit more narrow-minded, I guess, compared to talk of François. Anyway, so let's start. So there will be three parts, mainly corresponding to every 10 minutes. So yeah, I will give some overview and definitions, and in the second part I will talk about more affine fractals, and in the last part I will talk about the result, which is a dimension gap result and converse to Hutchinson theorem, and fourth part is not there. Okay. So yeah, there won't be any flow in this talk, it's very fractal kind of thing. Okay, so let's start. It will be pretty elementary, yeah. I hope. So let's start with the general setup. Let's X be a complete metric space, and let us take a tuple of contracting transformations of X. Okay. And let us call such a system iterated function system, IFS to be short. And it's not hard to see that when you are given a couple of contracting transformations like this, you will find a unique compact set, which we will call the attractor or the limit set of the IFS, which will satisfy this self-repeating behavior that it's equal to itself by the union of various images of these TIs. And yeah, so a nice way to study this limit set is this something called this coding map, which is just that you consider the shift space on n symbols, which each symbol will correspond to one of the contracting map, and just fix some x, arbitrary x in your space, and consider the following map. Take an infinite sequence and consider the compositions to the right of your contracting maps. And it's not hard to see that the limit will exist thanks to some fixed point theorem. It won't depend on X. So you get a well-defined map from this set of infinite sequences to X, which doesn't depend on X. And it's not hard to see that it's a continuous map. So its image, you can describe this invariant set which I just mentioned, is this K, the limit set. And okay, so for the rest of the talk, I will always take X to be RD, and D will be, in fact, this standard Euclidean metric, or it's by Lipschitz class. And so the limit set, people call it a similarity fractal or a self-similar set, if these TIs are contracting similarities, meaning that they are maps of the kind, some rotation metrics, so in the orthogonal group, with respect to your fixed Euclidean structure, and a contracting C, a scalar, and some translation parts. And more generally, it's called an affine fractal if TIs are contracting affine maps. So the linear part, I don't require it to be conformal. I take it to be a general invertible matrix. So, yeah. Okay, so some familiar examples. So this scheme of iterated function system is pretty flexible to construct many fractals. As you see, you can fit just and then family that you want. Some familiar examples, just to give some examples, you can middle third counter set, you can just self-similar set, and CR-splitting triangle, this space-filling curve, etc., etc. Yeah, I will talk about these things. Each one of them has a nice picture on the internet and some Wikipedia page, but etc. So now, before going on, I would like to also just mention some point of view on these fractals. You can also see this limit set as the repeller of some expensive map, single map. How can you do this? So let us be given this IFS of contracting affine maps of RD. And let us suppose that these images, so we suppose that this was a equal to, we have that there is such a set which is equal to the
image of itself by various contractions is a union, but they don't suppose this separation condition that it's a disjoint union,
sometimes called strong separation condition. And in this case, of course, you get a homeomorphism if there is a strong separation condition. This coding map, which takes an element of infinite sequence on the shift space and maps it to the limit, you get a homeomorphism. And as a result, you can transfer the shift action here, which is a non-invertible action on the shift space, to here, but just by conjugating. And you get a single map, which is a non-invertible end-to-one map from the limit set to itself. And yeah, so this fractal map, you when you restrict it to the piece of Tik, this compact set, it's given by the inverse of the contracting map. And you can extend this map any way you want. And then you get a expanding map on if you want some compact set which has this limit set as its repeller, so it's invariant set. So this is a parallel point of view to keep in mind. Which turns out to be useful, as I will mention a bit later, in the study of expansive maps and their dynamics. But okay, what do we want in this theory? So from fractal geometry point of view, one is interested in calculating dimensions of limit set of this attractor and some or various measures on them. For example, the classical question of Bernoulli convolutions is a part of this. And from dynamical point of view, when you see it as an expanding map, and in fact, in a spirit which I see very similar to SRB measures, you want to understand which invariant measures live on this repeller and which has the maximal dimension. So the measures that live on this attractor or the repeller of the expanding map, which maximizes the house, which has maximal Hausdorff dimension, or which sees most of the repeller. Okay. This is the things that we would like to understand in general. And very often these measures are also useful because then you can use ergodic theory and other things to study other things about this attractor. Okay, so I will mention just yes.
I'm confused because for me a Hausdorff dimension is just for a metric space.
Everything is in RD.
No, but does it mean the Hausdorff dimension of the measure?
What I mean is the point-wise dimension, in the sense that so you can think of it as the Hausdorff dimension of the largest set which has a positive measure, smaller set which has positive measure, or if it's like exact dimensional, but you can define it as you take a point, you take a small ball, and you look at the mass of this ball, take the logarithm, divide by the log of the radius. If the measure is exact dimensional, which will be our case, this limit will exist almost surely and will be equal to the same number, which is this, which coincides with this Hausdorff dimension of the. Sorry, that was a good one. Okay. So this is some notion that was suggested by.
So you're not interested in the measure of maximum entropy and on the repeller.
No, not necessarily. But it will be some measure of some equilibrium measure, but with respect to some potentials, which is not which are dynamically makes sense. Okay, so just to present some results. So the first systematic study of these objects were carried out by Moran quite a bit earlier, and then after a time lapse by Hutchinson. And just to state the results, let me tell you that I will tell a measure. So there, it's not hard to see that, in fact, given a probability vector, there exists a unique measure, unique probability measure, which satisfies this stationarity condition that is equal to its weighted averages by push forwards of itself. And in fact, such a measure is called self-similar or affine measure, depending on. In general, it's called a self-affine measure in the affine setting. And it's, of course, it's the image of a Bernoulli measure. So you can endow your shift system with the Bernoulli measure, and then you can push it forward by the coding map, and you get such a measure. It's also unique, not hard to see. And more generally, this attractor, of course, supports many invariant measures. If we are in the setting of expansive map, you can push forward any shift invariant measure, ergodic measure, and you will get some ergodic measure for your expanding map. But this special class, Bernoulli class, is called this self-similar or affine measures on the fractal. And what does this theorem say is that you take similarity IFS, okay? So conformal IFS is not rotation part here. And you suppose it satisfies some open set condition. Open set condition is some separation condition. Okay, it's some weaker than strong separation. So I won't define what it is, but you can think of it as strong separation. And so the images of the images of the similarities are sort of disjoint or yeah. And so what this theorem says is that there is an expression for the Hausdorff dimension of the associated attractor, and it's the unique real which satisfies this equality. Okay, so this was already calculated by Moran in 45. In fact, this is a precursor of Boven formula, which is what is more widely known as Boven formula. So you know the Hausdorff dimension, and also this is the part of that Hutchinson proved is that in fact, there exists a unique measure on the shift system such that when you push it forward, the dimension of the measure is equal to the dimension of the attractor to it. And moreover, it's a self-similar measure. So in fact, there is a Bernoulli measure on the shift system such that if you push it forward, it will be the unique measure which has the right dimension. So this S0 is called similarity dimension. Okay, so
could you recruit the open set condition?
It's a weaker form of strong separation condition. So you have this. What you want is that there exists some open set such that its images by different TIs only intersect on the boundaries. So strong separation condition asks you that the images of K attractor by TIs are all disjoint.
Yes.
But you can weaken it a bit so that there is an open set which contains it, so that it's the images of the open set just intersect on the boundary. Okay. Some weakening here.
It's weak, where you look at stronger, which is like a open neighborhood.
It should be weaker.
If you take the surface key carpet, I mean, you can touch at the point. So.
Mm-hmm.
It's disjoint. It's not disjoint, but if you take the images, they touch at just the point.
So you take a closed set, it can only intersect on the boundary. Interiors are disjoint. So
can you make a picture?
Huh?
A picture?
And so you need to find an open set which whose images are disjoint. Right? By TIs. TIs of, they are, what is TI, TJ, disjoint.
You may have the boundary.
Sorry?
You may have the boundary.
Yeah, it's
the interior.
The interior, yes. So this is a ball, and the interiors of the balls are disjoint. So this is weaker than asking that there is a compact set which are totally disjoint.
Okay.
But, if you want, you can just replace it by strong separation condition. The images are all disjoint, and then this theorem is even easier.
So in the second case, there's no minimum with S0 on Z.
Sorry?
I don't understand the second case. Yes. The second case when S0 is bigger than Z.
No, it cannot be bigger than Z. It lives in RD. So, yeah, so. What I mean is that S0, the same thing as
okay.
I was lazy. Okay, so yeah, so this theorem gives a pretty satisfactory picture under these two assumptions, and but it also naturally suggests two lines of research which correspond to these two underlying works. So what happens if you weaken the open set condition? So if you allow some overlaps in the images of Ti, and what happens if you look at general matrices, not similarity matrices, but affine matrices? Okay. So what happens if we drop the open set assumption, or more generally, how is the picture for affine fractals, so non-conformal linear parts? So for the rest, I will focus on the second question. So I will talk about affine setting. So this theorem is no longer true in the case, and we will see many aspects of this. But before going to second question, let me just mention that recent important results of Solomyak, Hochmann, Shmerkin, Marju, and many others, in fact, contributed considerably to the understanding of the first question. And we know much more than what we used to know in the last 10 years about Bernoulli convolutions or about this open set condition work of Hochmann. You can considerably weaken it and still get the same dimensions. But nevertheless, fundamental questions still exist in the first direction. Namely, there is something called exact overlap conjecture, which will tell you that unless there's exact overlaps, then the dimension should be precisely S0 given by this Moran formula. And dimensional absolute continuity, then there are finer questions of Bernoulli convolutions or more general self-singular sets. There are still many things to do in the first direction. But the second question is going more to the wild world and affine fractals. So the first cases of affine fractals was studied in the 80s by Bedford and McMillan, who calculated Hausdorff and Minkowski dimensions of very particular affine fractals. What I mean by particular is that so they had a linear part, some diagonal matrices, even the fixed diagonal matrices, and some tuned translation parts. Okay, so these are now called Bedford-McMillan carpets. They studied these things. And these were later generalized by many people, Gatsouras, Lelik, and Yon Perez, who studied sponges. So something that I learned when I prepared talks, that these kind of fractals where the linear parts are diagonal, they are called carpets or sponges, whether the dimension is 2 or higher. In dimension 2, they are called carpet. In higher dimension, yeah. Well, I was happy when I figured this out. So, they studied this particular type of fractals, again, and obtained some dimension formulas and established exact dimensionality results, which I just mentioned. And the next subsequent important work is that of Falconer, who in fact, without any algebraic assumption on the linear parts, he cooked up some potential and then the unique zero of the pressure associated with this potential, he showed that it gives the Hausdorff dimension of a typical, so this is underlined, typical affine fractal. Okay? Without any algebraic assumption, I will talk about this result because it will motivate some further development. So let IFS be given, linear parts, let AIs be the linear parts. So these are now general matrices in GLD contracting. And let sigma n star be the finite words. Okay, so words of finite length in this alphabet. And given a finite word, let AI denote the corresponding product. I take for each letter, I take the corresponding matrix, I take the multiplication. And let also, given a matrix, invertible matrix, let alpha I is denote its singular values. Okay, so the positive things in K decomposition. So let's consider the following map. Just take a finite word, consider the associated matrix, and take the multiplication of its singular values up to your fixed parameter S. Okay, if S is integral, you stop there. If not, you consider a bit more. For the moment, maybe this map is not motivated, but I will briefly mention it's very relevant, and the results will also manifest this. This is called by people Falconer singular value potential. It's some subadditive map. And you consider the pressure functional, which is so you take, you fix a length n, and you take all the words of length n, and you sum up their the values of the products of singular values of the corresponding matrices, take log one over n, this converges, and you get this one parameter family of S maps to P phi S. Okay, so this is not hard to see that it's some, since phi S, the everything is contracting, what you get is some strictly decreasing map.
Can you recall the definition of phi S?
Yes, this last thing. So it's the product of singular values in a decreasing order. So you have a matrix, you take its singular values, you order them, they are all positive numbers, positive things, and you multiply them up to S, S being a real between 0 and n. And so you define this thing, and it's a strictly decreasing map. It says some unique 0, which is called the affinity dimension. And in fact, it coincides with what I defined as the similarity dimension earlier. So this affinity dimension, of course, we defined it only using linear parts, and so it depends only on the linear parts. Okay? And now, in fact, I could give the picture to you, but it's really easy to see that using the definition of pi s, that this s0, which is the unique 0 of this potential, gives an upper bound, in any case, without any assumption, on the Hausdorff dimension of the associated fractal. So the fractal that you associate to your iterative function system, its Hausdorff dimension can never be bigger than this unique zero of this thing. And this is not hard to see because this expression is motivated by considering various decompositions of the image of a large cylinder. Either you cover it by a ball of radius alpha 1 or many balls of radius alpha 2, etc. This is some elementary argument. And S0 is the upper bound for the fractal. But what Falconer's theorem says is that it's also a lower bound for a typical fractal. So namely, fix some linear parts, a1 up to an, and suppose that they are sufficiently contracting. Okay. Once you fix this, without any algebraic assumption, some GRD matrices, then for almost every translation part, VI, with respect to Lebesgue measure, you can come up with a fine iterated function system. This has an attractor, and its Hausdorff dimension is precisely given by this number, with almost every translation part. So this is nice, but very frustrating, because in general, you want to know, given a particular one, it doesn't tell anything about it. So, and the general conjecture in this topic is that it's expected that under strong separation condition, or some separation condition, and reasonable algebraic assumptions on the linear parts, that Falconer's formula must be true without almost sure. So if deterministically you have some separation condition and some algebraic assumptions on the linear part, then this formula must be true. And since 88, this result is there's not much progress. And it was only, in fact, okay, it was only recently proved in last year in dimension 2 by the work of Baranyi, Hohmann, Rapoport, who showed that under indeed strong separation condition, and if the linear parts act strongly reducibly, so what I mean by strongly reducible is that a semigroup of matrices acting on RD, you say it's irreducible if it does not fix a proper non-trivial subspace. You say it's strongly reducible, it does not fix either a finite union of subspaces. Okay, so it's some generic thing which does not stabilize a finite union of proper subspaces. If you have these two assumptions, then in fact you can upgrade Falconer's by getting rid of almost every. And this is only true. This is only known in dimension. And okay, so the proof of this result, but also many other results in dimension theory of fractals, is based on analysis of equilibrium measures, which brings me to my subject now, and which are interesting in all right, such as in the question of Bernoulli convolutions, but also from dynamical perspective, the conjecture of Gatsouras-Perez that I mentioned also. Okay, so let's come back to now affine fractals, and so Kayenmaki considered some special measures on the shift set, which maximizes a notion called Lyapunov dimension. I will not tell you what it is, but the important thing is that he basically singled out as some measures which maximize this dimension, but which makes them the only candidates, so that the push forward to the fractal can have dimension equal to the affinity dimension. Okay, so we want to understand which measures on the fractal will have this affinity dimension, which is expected to be typical. It is a typical, but which is expected to be dimension. And so, yeah, he singled out a class of measures that I will call dimension maximizing measures, such that they are the only candidates to be the to maximize this dimension, to be equal to affinity dimension. So by analogy, they are the candidate SRV measures. Okay, these are dimension maximizing measures. And okay, you can also construct them via some variational principles, subadditive measures, and okay, by an equilibrium measure of some this Falconer singular value potential, but I won't go there. So yeah, to put the now I will talk about we are coming to the end. So I mean, toward last third. So to put the results into perspective, let me recall in this terminology Hutchinson's theorem that we saw. So it tells us that there is a unique dimension maximizer in the similarity setting, so in the conformal setting, there exists a unique dimension maximizing measure, and it is a Bernoulli measure on the shift system. And so regarding, so the next two results that I will mention will concern these two underlying words. Okay. So uniqueness aspects and the Bernoulli aspects. So regarding uniqueness aspects, another conjecture of Gatsouras Perez also anticipated that given an expanding map, its repeller must support a unique measure of maximal dimension, unique ergodic measure of maximal dimension. And this was refuted by Kaimaki Vilpolainen and Baral Feng by finding impact counterexamples using these affine fractals. So self-affine sponges, so these particular fractals with diagonal linear parts. As I told you, when they have separation condition, you can see them as expanding map. You can combine them into an expanding map. And they show that there are fractals which sponge type, which support several measures of maximal dimension. And so the associated expanding map also has this property. But in these examples, all the linear parts are reducible, so they are sponges, so they are diagonal matrices. And it was, on the other hand, it was also known that under strong irreducibility assumption, this assumption which popped up in Baran-Johmann-Rapoport theorem, in fact, if you have this up to dimension 3, then there is a unique DME measure. So this irreducibility assumption also forced unique. But yeah, we showed with Morris that in fact in dimension up to after 4, even if you have strongly reducible linear parts, you can find many examples where the fractal has more than one measure of full dimension. So let me tell you just a comment. It's not the main result I want to talk about. Let me just a comment on this thing. So in fact, it's known that in the typical regime, so you have some fractal, you have some affine maps, you have the linear parts, they are in GL4, they are invertible maps. The typical regime is that if you choose it in a random way, let's say with respect to R measure or whatever, they will generate some Zariski dense group. So in a sense, algebraically, they will see whole of the group. And in this case, it's known that there exists a unique DME measure.
How many matrices do you have?
More than one.
Okay.
Strictly more than one. And in this case, there exists a unique DME measure. So in this construction with strongly reducible in dimension 4 or higher, so what we had to do in particular is that we have to find a non-Zariski dense group and representation in R4. So it's PGL2 times PGL2 in reducible representation in R4, and the linear parts live in the image of this representation. And we could show that in this non-typical regime, typically, so in the zero measure set, typically you have more than one measure.
Is there a concept of ergodicity for this system or not?
So,
part?
So I mean, for me, the associated dynamics takes place on the shift space. And
so all of the measures are like the shift?
Yes.
Yeah,
they're all.
You can say, well,
they are all ergodic measures for the shift. But there is this uniqueness aspect which starts to fail in this affine world. When you go to the non-conformal world, uniqueness aspect fails. And
how many measures do you have?
So it's a good question. And so there is a recent work of Bocchi and Morris. And they show that for affine fractals, there is only finitely many of them. And they can give some upper bounds depending on dimensions. But this is some phenomenon. So you can ask these questions outside of a metric setting. So, and I expect that if you have general non-conformal maps, there can be infinitely many of them in general. But for when you have matrices, so linear algebraically defined fractals, they show that there are finitely many of them, and they can give some upper bounds. And yeah, certainly not unique. Okay, so the last part, so I will talk about this converse to Hutchinson theorem. Just it will be short part. So let us be given again an IFS, okay, affine maps. And let me recall it for the third time, Hutchinson theorem. If these are similarities, Hutchinson theorem tells me that there is a unique dimension maximizing measure, which is a Bernoulli measure on the shift space. So uniqueness aspect we talked about. So if you drop the conformality condition, uniqueness fails, and in various ways, by diagonal matrices or even in the strongly reducible case. But now I will talk about this Bernoulli aspect. Okay? So, and in fact, this Bernoulli aspect is also true for Bedford, McMullen, Carpel. So even in the non-conformal setting, when you have some diagonal maps, which are these Bedford McMullen carpets, which are genuinely self-affine sets. There is also unique Bernoulli measure, in fact, it was shown. And what we proved is the following alternative, that there is the following alternative. So fix an IFS and suppose that the linear parts act irreducibly on RD, so they don't preserve a subspace. Okay? Then you have the following thing. Either there is a positive gap between the supremum of every self, so you consider all Bernoulli measures, you push them, you look at their dimensions, and you have the affinity dimension. Either there is an epsilon gap between the supremum, or if you can come arbitrarily close to S0 or you can hit it, then you must be that every TI must be similarities. So it tells you that if your iterated function system contains at least one non-conformal map, matrix, the linear parts, then in fact the Bernoulli measures, they will not see at all the dimension of your fractal. So there will be a positive gap between the dimension of affine measures. So yeah, in particular, the existence of a Bernoulli measure, DME, entails, so it's kind of a converse to Hutchinson theorem, because if depends how you state it, but existence of a Bernoulli DME says that its affinities. Okay, so this result is deduced from a more general result about equilibrium states, blah blah. And in fact, you can also use some recent continuity results of Fenk and Schmerkin and show that in fact this dimension gap is locally uniform, meaning that if you perturb a bit the affine IFS, you will still this epsilon gap will persist. Okay, so I will finish just mentioning some words about the proof. So the proof makes use of subadditive thermodynamic formalism. The recent work of Bocchi Morris, which gave qualitative description of the DME measures, in particular, they showed that there are finitely many of them. And also the representations of linear algebraic groups and work of Benoit on Zariski dense semigroups in reductive groups. Okay. So let me just tell you lines of proof in dimension 2, because in dimension 2 it's considerably easier. So there are four parts in dimension 2 at least. So suppose that you have an irreducible iterated function system which has a Bernoulli measure of maximal dimension, okay? And then you irreducibility in dimension 2 implies that it is unique. The Bernoulli measure is unique, and moreover it satisfies some Gibbs inequality with respect to this Falconer potential. So in higher dimension this is not the case, but one can use Bocchi Morris anyway. So, if you Bernoulli assumption together with this Gibbs inequality forces that you do some little game, it's a very elementary game, that you get that specular radius of the matrices in the linear part, they have some additivity property. Okay, so when you multiply, so multiplicativity, when you multiply two matrices, their spectral radius multiply also. You get some relation like this by using this Gibbs inequality and the Bernoulli assumption. And okay, in higher dimensions, it's a form of it you still get. And then when you have this, if you have some matrices in BGL2 which generate something Zariski dense, their spectral radius cannot exhibit this multiplicative behavior. Okay. So if their matrices are somehow generic, when you multiply them, spectral radius will not be multiplicative. And this is in PGI2, you can also see it as a version of non-arithmeticity of length spectrum. And anyway, but this implies you that in fact the Zariski closure of your linear parts is not the full group. Okay. So in PGL2, then that means that Zariski closure, you can understand there are not so many possibilities. So either it's a reducible group, simultaneously upper triangularizable, or it's a compact group, or it's a irreducible but not strongly reducible. So meaning that a torus and its conjugate. So torus is a diagonal group in this setting and its conjugate. So you just need to, so the condition of irreducibility kicks out the reducible case. So you want to show that they are compact, so you want to conclude that everything is similarity if you have a Bernoulli DME. So you just need to get rid of this first set case and then, yeah. And then you get rid of it by rerunning the proof, going to the first step again, because then now you reduce the possible Zariski closures, and then you rerun the proof again and you show that it's also not possible. And okay, subsystems, I won't talk about it. So it's a way to turn about this gap by considering some subcollections of the iterates of these matrices, and then so that the gap becomes smaller and smaller for a different iterated function system, which is cooked up by using your iterated function system. Okay, yeah.
So thanks.
This was the only practical equation. I never thought about the picture, but what I can say is that it's there are two measures, but our construction is kind of cheating because they are very symmetric. They are like twin measures because we construct, they are coming from a representation of PGL2 times PGL2. So it's as if it's mu1 times mu2 and something of this nature. That they are not arbitrarily. Arbitrarily two different things. They are kind of twin objects, and they rely very much on the symmetry of the underlying iterative function system. Yeah. So the picture, I don't know, but that's most I can say. So it's not unique in the strict sense, but.
If you take mu1 times mu1 is not maximal dimension.
Yeah, so the construction rules out this kind of thing.
And this measure do have the other dimension of the limit set?
Sorry?
Does this measure have the dimension of the limit
set? Yes. Both of them have the same dimension and...
And this is not the case, other than does it is always such an invariant measure which has the... Does there is always a measure which has all the dimension of the inset, or not always.
Yeah, this was also a conjecture of Katsouras Perez, which tells you that there is always one and unique. So I talked about uniqueness aspect, and the fact that there might not be one was also a recent paper of Simons, Das and Simons, which showed that sometimes there is a gap between dynamical dimension, which is the supreme of dimensions of measures, and the Hausdorff dimension.
And is it possible to compute, to have an idea of how to compute the maximal dimension of the measures?
So there is a recent work of Feng from last year, which gives a Lodrobian type dimension formula for using entropy of the measure.
Yeah. And it does work for all of the.
Yeah, it was. It's very general. It works for any.
Feng, you said.
Feng, yeah, Dejong Feng.
Questions?
Thanks again.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we will have time right now.
Huh?
C'est quoi le dernier nom de la ville?
Feng.
Hein?
Feng.
Ah, Feng.
Oui.
Avec quoi?
Oui.